Hi, I'm Scott Hanselman, and it's Azure Friday. We're here with Christian Wade, and we're talking about Azure Analysis Services. Thanks for coming.
Thank you so much for having me, Scott. I'm very excited to be here.
Yeah. So Azure Analysis Services, is this something for me, or is this for like smarter PhD people?
This is for everyone. I mean, we're super excited about it. We recently launched an Azure Services in the cloud as a fully managed platform as a service. Mm-hmm. And Azure Services has a long and distinguished history. You know, it's been around a long time. It's the engine in Power BI. It's the engine in Power Pivot. It's the engine in SQL Server and Azure Services. So it's proven technology, and it's now in the cloud, and it just makes it so much easier for everyone to access it.
So what kind of things can I do with it?
Well, Azure Services is traditionally a technical BI product, technical mm-hmm. business intelligence, which means it's IT-led, mm-hmm. right? So it's going to give you that high-end scalability and allow you to create business intelligence models that are reused throughout an enterprise organization to promote consistent decisions and allow non-technical users to access data for decision making very easily. And it also has strong programmability and automation features, as you would expect, given that it's owned and managed by IT.
So if it's the engine behind these other services, why would I use that and not these other services? Why do I use this and not Power BI, or do I use them in tandem?
Yeah, that's a good question. So in fact, that's a good segue into this slide, because this shows where Azure Analysis Services fits in terms of Microsoft's overall business intelligence platform. And Microsoft is unique in that mm-hmm. it doesn't just focus on one particular area like self-service BI with Power BI. So right. We have an end-to-end modern business intelligence platform. It supports SQL Server Analysis Services on-premises, Azure Analysis Services in the cloud. There's a seamless migration story. And it also supports self-service BI and technical BI or corporate BI. And there's a seamless migration path across the camps. Which is really what makes Microsoft unique in having this complete end-to-end modern business intelligence platform.
Mm-hmm. So I'm seeing it here.
Yes.
What does that mean for modeling cloud data?
Yeah, so it means that I can have high-end scalable models in the cloud deployed very, very quickly without any of the manageability concerns that I used to have. I can spin up environments very, very quickly. This is unprecedented. If you've been in BI for a while like me, this is a real game changer. Mm-hmm. You can spin up environments very quickly based on unforeseen usage trends and just respond to changing business needs much more easily and just allow businesses to focus on running their business rather than managing all of these infrastructure and worrying about availability. And it's very scalable, very available, and very mm-hmm. relatively very, very easy to use.
How was this done before? I was like, oh, quick, we need an analysis services instance.
Yeah, it's so like, quick, right. Let's go and create one. And it's like, let's go and ask for a server. How long is that going to take? Maybe a week. How long is it going to take to set up? Just a few days. Just give me a few days. And then even on a virtual server, right, you install analysis services, you install drivers, you configure it for optimum hardware usage. And not a lot of people actually know how to do that. With this, you can spin up a server in 5 or 10 seconds. I mean, it's the fastest Azure Services installation I have ever seen. It's insane, absolutely insane.
So all of the administrivia, but not just that, but the best practices that yes. encapsulate how to run a good one.
Are just in the box.
It's handled.
It's just handled, outsourced.
See, I was mentioning this with when I talked to the folks in container services and the folks that are doing things in DocumentDB. These are all instances of something that we used to be able to do on premises that we now do in the cloud, and now entire pages of my resume yep. are becoming a checkbox.
Yeah.
So you probably have like page 2 of your resume yeah. is setting up analysis services. That's now a checkbox.
That's just a checkbox.
That's gotta
right.
hurt.
So it hurts, but we're evolving and we're just excited. The excitement about the product mm-hmm. is overshadowing the feelings of having to learn new stuff. But it's all good.
So then now, what do you do with all this free time?
Yeah, exactly. Now I can just write even more code on Azure Analysis Services, given that it's so programmable, and I can optimize my data loads for big data sets very easily using strong management APIs. So yeah, it's all good.
So you start thinking about the BI stuff.
Right,
and not
in
about
a completely different way. In a completely different way. It's a completely new world for automation and scalability and the integration with DevOps processes. Spinning up a server on the fly as part of an automated test run. This is all stuff you could never do before.
As part of an automated test
run? As part of an automated test run, you can spin up a server and you can deploy a database to it, get data into it, run a bunch of tests, and then just drop the server on the fly as part of an OS. I mean, this is just insane. It's like science fiction. If you've been in BI for a long time,
it's like science fiction. Do you have some other diagrams that show how this
fits
into
so
your life?
So this is a typical architecture. So our preferred front end is Power BI because it has such a rich visualization stack. Mm-hmm. We support other ones like Excel and third-party vendors as well. And we support mashing up data from on-prem and cloud data sources. And we have different modes. So we have this in-memory compression mode that supports very big data sets compressed significantly. So in the demo that I'm going to do, I'm using this New York taxi data set, mm-hmm. which is a pretty well-known data set by the data science community.
Right.
And it covers all of the taxi trips across a date range in New York. So you can imagine that's a lot. And it's actually been exploded a little bit just to show off the scalability of an Azure services. So we have 2 billion rows. It's about 1.8 terabytes in its raw form in SQL DW. And then when you're managing that volume of data, mm-hmm. it's not like self-service BI that you just schedule it to refresh the whole database every night or something. Or it's like a data warehouse. You need to do an incremental managed load, right?
Right.
So in order to do things like parallelized incremental data loading, you need a management API. And so we have a very rich management API called the Tablet Object Model, which is exposed in C Sharp.
You're saying the tab?
The Tablet Object Model.
Okay.
Yeah, it came out in SQL Server 2016, and it works with Azure and Azure Services because the compatibility across the two products is pretty seamless.
Right.
And I don't need a virtual machine to run it. I can run it in Azure Functions. I can have a complete end-to-end cloud platform, fully platform as a service, software as a service.
And to be clear, fully managed, that's what you're saying?
Absolutely, fully managed.
I'm not thinking about not remote even, desktoping into things.
Absolutely. I don't even need to know what remote desktop is, right?
And before you do your demo, if you wouldn't mind just backing up one slide, I wanted to point out one thing that was really significant is that you are very likely already doing this now.
Absolutely.
This isn't an either-or scenario.
Right.
You don't have to abandon this good work.
Right, absolutely.
These things can work together.
Absolutely. And there are various efficiencies. You know, you can locate this in the same region as your Power BI service implementation, and there's a bunch of new efficiencies available.
All right, let's see some demos.
Okay, absolutely. Let's do it.
Of course, now you're remote desktoping, the irony.
Yeah.
Are you remote desktoping in to get to a browser?
No, into a virtual machine that I've got set up with a demo.
Okay.
Okay, so I'm here in the Create Blade, and I've got some different pricing tiers here, and it ranges from just the entry level to really big servers with many, many processors on there. I'm not allowed to disclose exactly how many, but take my word for it, this thing is big, and 100 gigabytes of...
Can you change it if I pick standard and I can...
Absolutely, so scale up and down will be here very, very soon. That's mm-hmm. being developed right now. And I can also pause it, and I can do all of that in an automated fashion.
Nice.
Right. So I'll go ahead with that tier, and I'll go ahead and create. And this thing takes 5 or 10 seconds. Like I said, this is insane. If you've spent the last 15 years setting up business intelligence systems on-prem or even on virtual machines, this is just insane, right?
Yeah,
the first time I saw this, I was like, no, there's some smoke and mirrors going.
But, yeah, when I make a web farm in Azure, and it says scaling a web farm, I guess, the 90s, that was it, scaling a web farm.
So there it is, and
that
was how quick it was. It's insane, and then the pause button there, as I say, scale up and scale down is coming. So I'm now going to switch over to Azure Functions, because if you remember, I'm going to perform a parallelized incremental data load into a massive compressed in-memory model, right? Mm-hmm. So I'm going to kick this off.
And Azure Functions for this kind of compute is brilliant, because you could make a VM and remote into it and run something at the command line.
Right.
You could try to do it from your computer, but that would be totally inappropriate because you wouldn't be in the same network.
Right, right.
Azure Functions is a great place to say, do this work, and I don't want to think about computers.
Absolutely. And if you've got current implementations that do it the old way, maybe with integration services, mm-hmm. calling into the tablet object model through a script component or something, mm-hmm. all of that works, right? The compatibility is pretty seamless. The migration is painless, and you can do it chunk by chunk.
Right.
You can do it, yeah. So I'm here in Management Studio, which also works. The management experience is the same. And I'll just show you that I'm not connected to I'm using Azure Active Directory authentication, and I'm connected to a URL, which is the server, and it's actually performing that parallelized process and operation in the background as an online operation. So I'm actually going to show you the actual data in a moment as well. Mm-hmm. And if I run this, so you can see there are this particular table is pretty wide. Look at the number of columns on this. Wow. And there are over 2 billion rows in this thing.
Wow.
Right? So
did it finish loading?
It's performing in the background. And it's partitioned by month for 12 years, 144 partitions. So if I refresh this, this is my log. This is how we set things up traditionally. Mm-hmm. So this is showing me that it's going to increment the. So it's as though I've just started a new month. So I'm going to increment the partition range like a rolling window.
Oh, I see. It found a new month.
So right.
It went from January to February.
Exactly,
there.
Exactly.
Nice.
And so it will remove the oldest partition, refresh the previous five, assuming those are the hot partitions that can have data changes.
Right.
And then it will create a new one. And it's doing all of that as we speak as a parallel operation, a parallelized processing operation. Okay. So given that it's an online operation, let's go ahead and have a look at the data. It's a pretty interesting data set. Why not? And we'll use Power BI Desktop to do that. And so I'm connected here to the same server. Mm-hmm. And here you can see how wide this table is that has 2 billion rows in of all the trips in New York City.
That's insane.
So yeah, absolutely. So check this out. Check how quick the speed is on this thing, right? This is over 2 billion rows, just instant gratification.
Yeah.
You know, it's like interactivity at the speed of thought. This is insane. Like it's as though I'm running Power BI Desktop on my laptop and it's all local, but I happen to not have 100 gigabytes of memory and 20 cores on my laptop, right? This thing's running out there and the network latency is not an issue at all, as you mm-hmm. can see. Right, so let's make this a little bit smaller. And now we'll drag in, say, revenue per trip is one of my metrics.
I hope the New York taxi people are using this.
Absolutely. Well, they'd better be watching this if they want to. You know, these medallions cost like $1 million, right?
Yeah, yeah,
and then you can operate taxis. And if I'm paying $1 million for a medallion, I'm going to want to learn how to optimize my business. Where are the best pickup locations? Mm-hmm. At what time? How can I optimize my routes? You know, how can I maximize tips and minimize tolls and etc. So I'm going to drag in the top 10 zip codes. So we've got two clear outliers here.
Yeah.
And so we want to see those on a map because this is Power BI. We've got rich visualization stack. So I just need to find, pick up latitude, longitude, and revenue, and just make this a little bit bigger. As you can see,
nice. They're bound.
Just instant gratification. That's just clicky, clicky, draggy, droppy, instant gratification. It's insane, right?
That's fantastic.
Yeah. Right. And then check out the Power BI cross-filtering is just so smooth. You know, I'm gonna click on that, and it's doing this cross-filtering. So it's telling me that the pickup zip code in New York with the highest revenue per trip is JFK. Right, okay, and where are the pickup locations at JFK? Well, let's zoom in and find out. That's interesting. Some of them are actually on the freeway. People are cheating. They're coming out of coming off the plane, and they're impatient, and they want to get wherever they're going. And
they leave the terminal.
Leave the terminal and just run out on the freeway. And I'm probably exaggerating, but you can start imagining the story. Hopefully, it's all safe, right? There's traffic or something. So you can see that I've gone from 2 billion rows, 2 billion with a B, and I've come down to the individual taxi pickup spot. You know, from 2 billion to one, just like that. Yeah, you know, that's the power that we have here. And then I'll click on the other outlier, which, surprise, surprise, is, let's find out. It's just refreshing.
Be LaGuardia?
That will be LaGuardia. Let me just refresh this again. It'll be LaGuardia.
Yeah.
And just let that refresh. I'm not sure why that's taking a bit longer than usual.
I'm actually flying into.
There it is. It's refreshing. It's coming in. We're taking a bird's eye view of New York, and now we're in LaGuardia.
I think it's funny that you were on the edge of apologizing for 2 billion rows taking about 3 to 4 seconds.
Exactly. It's absolutely insane. Absolutely insane.
I think you're good.
You know, I'm just trying to be nice. You know, trying to be courteous. You know. Yeah. Absolutely.
I'm sorry this terabyte data set took 3 seconds to return.
Yeah, insane.
This is amazing. And there are people out there who have giant data sets who may have felt helpless in the past.
Right.
They can't do this kind of analysis.
Right.
And now they can.
Exactly. And I need no technical skills, right? I don't even need any advanced power user modeling skills, right? Everything is predefined for me. I can connect to this from any device, and I can just get data at my fingertips for instant decision making. It's, yeah, absolutely very powerful. So let's see how we're doing over here. If this is quite finished processing, we'll just give it another 30 seconds or so. So naturally, we would expect that pickups from the airports would have a higher revenue per trip, given that the trip duration is going to be longer, right? Mm-hmm. So we need to put this into context a little bit. So let's drag in trip duration minutes, break that out by trip count, make it a little bit smaller, and make it a chart. And I need to just apply this cross-filtering. So we can see that most trips are done in 15 minutes, but that's mainly all the Manhattan trips, right? So then now with the magic of cross-filtering in Power BI, I can click there and I can see that JFK,
it takes 45 minutes.
You know, it takes 45 minutes for the ride from JFK, whereas the ride from LaGuardia, interestingly, is done much more quickly, right? 15 to 30 minutes. So if I paid $1 million for a medallion to operate my taxis in New York, and I want to figure out what are the best pickup locations, I want to get the best bang for my buck, right? I want quick trips, maximum revenue per trip. So evidently, LaGuardia is a pretty good choice. And that's just a little gem that we just stumbled on. You know, if you actually took some time to analyze it, you could find a lot of strong insights that you could actually take action on.
This is a pretty fantastic overview of analysis services. Let's just take a brief moment to see if that last thing is loaded up, and I think we're out of time.
Absolutely. So it's actually done successfully, parallel process, 2 billion rows. And not only that, I'll just quickly show you back here. If I refresh, if you take a look at the last refresh time, just to show there's no smoke and mirrors here.
Yeah, none of this was fake.
The last refresh time is just enterprise ready. This thing, we're in public preview. This thing is enterprise ready.
2 billion rows in the time it took you to watch one Azure Friday.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.